When we have no clue what we need. And for that we give God thanks and we give God praise. Let us pray. Great and merciful God, this moment is about you. It's about what you're doing. May our hearts and our minds be open to you, to your word, to your spirit, and yes, even to each other. That the words of your servant's mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts might somehow be found acceptable in your sight. For you are our Lord and our strength and our blessed Redeemer. And it's in the name of Jesus the Christ that we pray. Amen. We continue today in this series of Prepare the Way, and here we are on this third Sunday of Advent, and we have this emphasis for the day of do. It's just a two-letter word, do, D-O, and it's about action. It's about what we will move into. That's really the call here, and the Advent emphasis for the day in this third week of Advent is joy. We know this because we lit the pink candle on today. And I really enjoy when we get to the point of lighting the pink candle because I know that's the joy Sunday. I know that's the joy Sunday. We start out with hope and then the second week's about peace. But the third Sunday in Advent is always about joy. And that just gets me going. You know, it's the third week. It also lets me know that we're just almost to the birth, almost there. And so we come to this time in our Advent season, and it's exciting. But what are we to do about joy when what we have is John the Baptizer out in the desert preaching about repentance? He's telling people to pause and to get right. He's showing them signs of where they're missing the mark, and he's telling them to heed the warnings. In today's vernacular, he would basically be telling them to read the label because they're coming out to find out about this new thing, and he's preparing them, letting them know what it is that they are signing up for. And all too often, we find ourselves in the midst of situations, in the midst of circumstances, relationships, or opportunities without really knowing what we're getting ourselves into. And what John is laying out here for the people is that in order to enter this new relationship, to enter this new realm that God is ushering in, you first must understand this thing called repentance. And so you need to read the labels. You need to understand what's going on, and particularly what is expected of you. And, you know, as I was preparing for this and I was thinking about this idea of reading labels and warnings, I was looking at various items around my house and just noticed that just about everything has a warning label on it. Did y'all know toothpaste has a warning label on it? Toothpaste has a warning label. Your pillows have warning labels on them. And you know, I think you can go to prison if you take that tag off your mattress too, right? I think that's true. I mean, that's there. So I took mine off, you know, because it was making noise under there. You know, it's a big old thing and it just made noise. I didn't heed the warning. I read the label, but I did not heed the warning. But do you know why we have those warning signs? Why we have those labels, those warning labels that are there? Well, we have them there because somebody, somewhere, at some time, tried whatever that was that they're telling us to no longer try. Somebody messed it up for everybody, and now all of us have to read the labels, amen? So that we understand what not to do. And so essentially that's what John is doing out in the desert. He's helping them to read the labels, to heed the warnings, to pay attention to the signs that are before them. And he begins by telling them that their lives need to be marked by a fruit of repentance. To just say, I repent, and to be baptized wasn't enough. But in fact, their lives needed to bear fruit of repentance. If we have truly repented and we've committed ourselves to Christ, then our lives will show it. Yes. Whether we ever utter the words or not. Yes. But our lives will reflected. And so in verse 8, he's basically telling them to prove you have changed by the way you live. And oh, he wasn't just talking to a few people. He was talking to everyone. He was naming that everyone needed to repent. Everyone needed to understand what it would mean to follow this one called Jesus. And he's almost as though he could read the minds of the people that were there. And he just let them know that your name and your fame will not save you. So don't come here talking about, oh, but we're the children of Abraham. We're all right. We already have the blessings and the promises of Abraham. What are you talking about? Of repentance. We are already made up. We're Grace United Methodist Church. What are you talking about? We live west of Crenshaw. What are you talking about? We got it all figured out. You just leave us alone. But John said, oh, no, 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 no. Don't get it twisted up in here, because God could make these stones the children of Abraham, and God could bless these stones with those same promises. And I don't know about you, but I want my space. I don't want a stone in my space. Amen. I don't even want a headstone when I'm done. I want the stone to know that I'm going to occupy my own space. I'll take care of my own praise. I don't need the rocks crying out for me. But you know that John's word must have been true, and it must have been right, and it must have settled with the people, because as we discussed in our Bible study on Wednesday, they didn't argue with John. When John called them a brood of vipers and he told them how wicked they were, they didn't argue with him. Usually, you know, if somebody said, you know, Lisa, you're just a horrible person, you'd be like, wait a minute. All of you would be like, wait a minute, she's not. Okay? Like, wait a minute. But you see, I mean, you'd be like, wait, you know, you would take issue with that. But they didn't. Instead, the crowd asked, what then should we do? If we are so bad and if we do need to repent, what then shall we do? And you know, when the crowd decides it wants to make a change, a miracle is just around the bend. And John instructs them, and he says, do what you would not do on your own. Do what does not always center on you winning. Do what does not always depend on you being right. Do what does not always call you to be singled out or for you to receive all the praise. Instead, do that which requires Christ to be present in your life. Don't function on your own. In other words, give coats to those who don't have coats. Give food to those who are hungry. Sounded a lot like Jesus as he was teaching, didn't he? Because he was preparing the way. Just as you and I are preparing for the coming of the Christ. The crowd asked, what then should we do? He told them, and then the tax collectors and the soldiers ask, what then should we do? And essentially, I believe what John gets to in this third week of Advent is he tells them to do what gives you joy and brings joy to others. Because there's great joy in giving. Just imagine if you have two coats and someone comes along who doesn't have one, and you're able to relinquish one of those to someone else who is in need. That, to a follower of Jesus, is a joyous occasion. That's joy. Now, some of us are thinking, but wait a minute, I like both coats. And, you know, the one I like to wear, you know, with these colors and, you know, when the temperature's so-so. And then that other one, you know, my mama gave me that one. So I want to hang on to that one, too. And we don't find joy in even the mere thought of giving one of them away. But see, joy in giving one of those coats away is found in the fact that you're able to see who made the coats possible in the beginning. Who made it possible for you to even have coats to consider giving away? Who made it possible for you to have food enough that you can let some of it go? I mean, all of us could stand to push back from the table just a little bit every now and again. I mean, I'm just saying. That wasn't in the script, so let me get back on here. So what John is getting at is that that the people need to read the labels so they know what they're getting themselves into. The same is true for us. As we say we truly want to follow Jesus and we want to be Christians in our hearts, then yes, we too need to read the labels so that we know what we're getting ourselves into, so that we know that it's not just about the melodious songs that the choir sings. It's not just about the well-crafted sermon that the pastor is preaching right now. It's not just about acts of charity that we do only at the holidays. It's not about a grand reputation out in the community where people know and call our names. No, we have to read the label. And when we read the label, we come to understand that Advent truly is about expectations and about preparations. It's about getting ourselves ready and ensuring that those around us are ready to receive Jesus into our lives and into their lives. And this is a critical point here, because all too often we miss out on the joy because of what's happening around us. And because we don't feel all excited about what's happening, or because we don't truly understand or grasp what's happening, we say there's no way in the world I could have anything that even resembles joy. Well, you may recall that when the Israelites were in captivity, the whole time, both times, they were taken into exile, God sent the prophets to them to proclaim good news, to let them know that the situation that they now found themselves in was not where they would always be. But he sent word to them that they would be restored, that they would be released. And I believe the same is true here with John, that John has been sent as a prophet to the people as he prepares the way for Jesus, to let the people know that their fortunes and their futures have been changed from judgment to hope, from destruction to restoration, from oppression to liberation, and from dread to praise. And beloved, the same is true for us, that in this time of Advent, in this time of preparation and anticipation, though we have not come to that glorious moment yet, we can anticipate that that glorious moment is yet coming and that we shall be a part of it. That's what John is trying to help the people recognize. See, it takes a knowing what you're signing up for, to trust, to believe, and to live through captivity, to live through disappointment, to live through hurt and pain, all the while singing songs of hope, singing songs of peace, singing songs of freedom, calling on the deliverer while you are still yet in chains, preparing the way for the one to come. What John was showing the people in his time was that they had to read the label, to know what's expected, to know the signs and the symptoms are not substitutes for the real deal. They point to possibilities, but they are not the substance of the matter. And just as the crowd asked John the Baptizer, "What then shall we do?" we ask, "What shall we do to have joy today?" Well, beloved, we have to read the label and we have to understand that there is a difference. First of all, we have to understand that there's a difference between happiness and joy. All too often we use those words synonymously and they are very different. For happiness lets you know its definition just in its name itself. For happiness depends on what is happening. If you want to know how happy I am, just look at what's happening or what is not happening, and you'll know my degree of happiness. For happiness is about an external thing, external movings, external movements, external occurrences. And they move almost like the wind, constantly. So if your gauge of how you're doing is based on your happiness, it may seem like you need a real diagnosis sometimes, right? Because it's up and a down, and it's up and it's down. Well, that's happiness. That's what it is. That's how that's supposed to work. But joy is an internal and spiritual state that is solid, that is secure, and does not shift based on what's happening. Joy is solid, it's safe, it's secure, it's constant because of what already occurred way back in that manger. I think you need to turn me up, Kwame. They didn't turn me up. You see the difference? See, joy is internal. And what's happening around me doesn't change my joy factor. And my granddaddy had two songs he used to sing. One of them, I love it when he rear back and sing it. That song was, "This joy that I have, the world didn't give it, and the world can't take it away." And when he get real down into the song, he would say, "This joy that I have, the world didn't give it, and the world sure can't take it away." That's how they say it in Alabama. Sure can't take it away. See, that's when you encounter people in the midst of dire situations and they still are standing strong, and not that fake and phony, "Oh, I'm gonna be all right." Not that, but you know, come what may. All hell is breaking loose around them, but they're still able to just keep putting one foot in front of the other, to keep inhaling and exhaling, and though that's not how it's going to end for them, that's joy. That's joy. And if you truly got joy, now that's when we might think you're crazy. Because we're like, shouldn't you be balled up in the corner somewhere? Shouldn't you have the blanket over? Shouldn't you just be walking around in public with a blanket over your head? How are you showing yourself? You know what I'm saying? I mean, just when you're sure of who you are and certain of whose you are, joy sustains you in the midst of doctor's appointments. It sustains you in the midst of people running your name through the mud. It sustains you when you forget just how beautiful and how wonderful you truly are. Joy will sustain you, but you only know that if you read the label. And the label we have to read is this one, the Holy Bible. That's the label we have to read, because when we read this label, we get inside there and we see that just right up toward the front, right there in Genesis, we read the label and we see that God made us in God's own image and God's own likeness. So that means all the goodness that is in God is in us. When we read the label, we continue on into Exodus and we see the story that lets us know that though we may feel like we're wandering, but though we may feel like we're lost, though we may feel like we're in a desperate, desolate, desert-like place, we'll find out when we read the label that He'll feed us by day and guide us by night. If you read the label, you'll come across Ruth, and down in there you'll see that you may have to adjust, or you may have to lose some relationships in order to follow God the way that God intended. You may find out that as you read Ruth, that your husband or your wife may not come packaged the way that you envisioned. And oh, guess what? As you read the label, you find out that the one you started with may not be the one you end with either. But you only get that if you read the label. That just freed somebody up right there. Amen. We are still talking about joy. When you read the label, you may come to Job and find out that the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away, but the Lord never ever leaves you alone. As you read the label, you may see in Acts that Jesus says that after the Holy Spirit comes upon you, that you shall receive power to be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth. Oh, when you read the label. You'll find out that the race is not given to the swift nor to the strong, but the one that endures until the end. That is what your joy is made of. But you only know about joy if you read the label. If you watch CNN, if you watch CNBC, ABC, BET, and HGTV, you won't know a whole lot about joy. You'll know a whole lot about misery, and you may know a little bit about happiness. Oh, but if you read this label, you'll understand. You'll understand what joy is all about. When you read the label, you can have joy because you know what to expect. You'll know what to expect because it tells you. Amen? You'll know why you're preparing. You'll know what you're being prepared for. For John preached this message and people found it to be good news. Though the words he was using didn't sound like good words, they knew that on the other end of it, that there was some good news. Not happy news. Good news. Good news that they could count on. For John let them know that there is one coming. There is one coming, because John was preaching so profoundly with such great conviction, they started asking, John, are you the one? John said, no, there is one to come. I'm only baptizing you with water. There is one who will come who will baptize you with the Spirit. One that I'm not even worthy to bend down and lash his shoes. I'm not the one, but he's coming. And since we know he's coming, your role between now and then is simply to prepare and to anticipate, to expect his coming. And in that preparation and that anticipation and that expectation, you'll find your joy. And when that joy comes upon you and rests within you, the world can go on about its business. When everybody around you is asking, why me? Why this? Why that? You saying, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
You're saying, thank you, Jesus. Though I may not understand what's going on, thank you, Jesus. Though I may not know what they're trying to tell me, thank you, Jesus. Though I may not know why people are treating me this way, thank you, Jesus. You got joy and you don't know what to pray, you know the Lord have mercy is sufficient. Joy. That pink candle. Every year Ruby takes me back to let me know I made it back to the pink candle again. If I never see another one, I know that right now it's letting me know that joy is mine. And I hope as you look at it, you can make that claim as well. That joy, come what may, joy may not understand, but joy may not feel like I have enough, but joy. I know what direction I'm going, but joy. These doctors are giving me no joy. Oh, that joy. These children, joy. That neighbor, joy. That perfect joy. Discipleship for anyone that needs a Savior.
who needs to name Jesus Christ, wants to name Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, to lead you and guide you throughout the balance of your days, then this invitation is for you to come to say yes to Jesus. The second invitation is about membership. And if the Lord has spoken to you today and said that today is the day and grace is the place, then we invite you to come to be a part of this great fellowship, where we might walk with you this journey of discipleship as we all figure it out together day by day. There are no perfect people here. Nobody has all the answers to you. But we know who has them, and we're all willing to seek that one and to seek those answers together. So we invite you to come. The third invitation is about prayer. We know that God is everywhere and God hears us wherever we sit, wherever we stretch ourselves out or kneel, however, wherever God hears us. But there's just something special about coming to the altar. Kneeling or standing at the altar, pouring it out before God. And today you may want to pray, God, restore my joy. Yet again. But wherever you decide to pray, just pray. But right now the altar of the